Geoff Achison at TexPlays. So you're a lad from a small country town, Malmesbury, mm-hmm. Victoria, about 500 people. Mm-hmm. So how does a young bloke in Malmesbury get motivated?
But I got it in my head as a kid that I wanted to be a musician. And I had no idea how I was going to make that happen. And I did hit rock bottom at one point when I guess out of despair, because I had left school and had realised that playing the little pubs and so on with my mates was not the path. I had to find another way. My most vivid memory of being moved by music for the first time, I've told this story before, was hearing Joe Cocker belting out The Letter through my mum's little transistor radio. And that sat up on the mantelpiece in the kitchen, and it was always tuned to 3UZ. And I had gone into the kitchen. I'm thinking I probably went in to steal a biscuit or something, and this song came on the radio, and I can still remember very clearly being absolutely transfixed and listened to that voice belting out that song with the backing singers and a horn section. It's a really powerful band. I'd never heard anything like it. I remember my uncle for a birthday, and it may have been my 8th birthday. I'd been given a little Chinese harmonica, and I played it, and I had a repertoire of about half a dozen tunes that I'd made up. I'd had a go at various times at the drums. I wanted to be a drummer. I'd had a go at trumpet. I'd had a go at saxophone. But I think I got the guitar in my hands when I was about 9 or 10.
You did some gigs with your dad.
Yeah, from the age of 13, I was doing gigs with my dad's little dance band. I can tell you, I remember doing my first gig and getting paid for the first time. I got paid $10. I used to ride my bike. I used to get up at 6 in the morning and ride my bike about 4 kilometres to a farm in Drummond down the road, and work from about 8 in the morning till about 8 at night, and he would pay me $10.
How important were Alan Watson and Neil Matthews to your career?
Oh, enormously. It was that whole gang. So Al came along because he heard there was this band happening, and Al would kind of headhunt for no other reason than he wanted to invite people back to his place to jam. He was a very eccentric character. His story is extraordinary in itself. He was found in Fitzroy Gardens, wrapped in newspaper by a policeman. This is in the 1930s. And he was ultimately adopted by a very rich family of wine merchants, very wealthy family. When his parents died, Alan inherited the family fortune.
Well, who knows what's good luck and what's bad luck?
Yeah, that's right. So with the family fortune, he did. It's like the old joke. Of the jazz musician, you know, having his fortune, and the reporter saying, "So what are you going to do with the money?" And he said, "Well, I'm just going to play gigs until it runs out."
Right. The older guy, yeah. So you really, really cut your teeth in that era.
Well, Al's place was, it was like our conservatory of music.
So a conservatory of music with an endless flow of wine. Sounds like a great place.
Yeah.
Sounds like a great place to be. Yeah.
In the late 1980s, I had left school, and I'd gone through a couple of jobs. I worked at a supermarket for a couple of years, and then I was working at a factory. And clearly, they were not the things that I wanted to do with my life. The only thing I was sure about was that I wanted to be a professional musician. And at some point, I just took the leap. I just moved to Melbourne, and I had very little plan other than knowing that if I wanted to be making a go in the music industry, I had to be in Melbourne, in the big city. I'd met a jazz singer, a lady called Jackie Gordian, and she sang in a blues band called Blues on the Boil. We moved into a house together, and that house became an artist colony. There were several others moved in, and so there was, I don't know, there was something like 7 or 8 of us living there. I arrived there with $40 in my pocket, old HQ Holden and the Gibson Les Paul that I'd bought. And that was all my money was gone. I had $40 left. My association with Blues on the Boil, as a fan at first, and then they discovered I played guitar. It was Gordon Pendleton, the drummer, who came and had a coffee with me just because I was a familiar face, and he started talking to me. And he said, "Man, you play?" He said, "Well, you got to bring your axe. We'll get you up to do a couple of tunes." And from that, I got into a blues band called the Just Blues Band. So that's what we were going to do. We were on a mission to spread the word. So we were going to play just blues, nothing else. That was with a harmonica player called Steve Sepro. We had that band for, I don't know, it was probably all of 18 months or something. But at one point, we opened a show for Dutch Tilders and the Blues Club. And we were all fans of Dutch. We were all very well aware of who he was. So it was very, you know, he was the big star in the scene. But that's where Dutch got to see me play, and the next time I went to the Windsor Castle, by then he knew my face, and I guess he liked my playing enough that I got up and jammed with Dutch.
Yeah, so no doubt that was a step forward for you.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, that was the first time I could truly say that I'd gone professional.
Lloyd Spiegel told me that as a young fella, he'd go and watch you play, and he'd sit under your mic stand, and every time you drop one of your picks, he'd pocket it and take it home.
That's where they went.
Yeah. So, Lloyd, if you're listening, Geoff wants his picks back. Let's talk about some of your albums. Another Mile, Another Minute is one of my personal favourites. Right. The blues element is there. Yeah. There's a lot of R&B type sounds. What got you to that frame of mind?
A lot of the songs these days, before I go into the studio, I will make demos to let the musicians that I'm hiring know, you know, roughly what it is that I want.
One of the tracks on the album is Delta Dave. It sounds like an interesting character.
Yeah. This is a song about, you know, about a real guy. It's a real story. He was a mate of mine. He was one of the guys on the scene, and one of the first people I met when I arrived in Melbourne.
Max Merritt told me he was always fortunate to have great musicians working with him. And I can see you have no shortage of that caliber of musician working with you. So how do you track those types of guys?
I'll just say very quickly, Max was another guy who was a big inspiration for me. I just loved him. What a great singer. Yeah. Great delivery. I remember hearing Western Union Man for the first time, which again was not his tune, but for me, you know, Max's version is the one. You know, no matter who he had backing him up, the musicianship was just A1. I had met Mal Logan before I left. Mal had been playing in my band, and I guess I got some phone numbers of some other guys of a similar sort of caliber, and one of those numbers was Roger McLaughlin.
Good choice.
Yeah, well, he was my... I was a bass player when I was a teenager, and Roger McLaughlin was my favourite bass player. And the other guy at that time was... Kevin Murphy, that became the Souldiggers. We began our residency out at St Andrews Hotel. We did that for the next 17 years or something. A couple of live albums, we did a DVD out there.
Let's talk about your songwriting. Mm. The one thing I find missing from your albums are filler tracks.
You... okay, I guess that's a good thing.
It is, yeah. I mean, look, I know how hard it is to write one good song, but let alone when you can fill an entire album with good songs, as you've managed to do.
Oh, thanks, mate.
Yeah. How do you approach songwriting? How do you get yourself to a point where you're happy with enough songs to record a whole album?
And because I've come from the rhythm section, I was a bass player, and I think I'm quarterly... minded, so I'll just play chords and a rhythm, some sort of groove, and quite often what I'm what I'm trying to envisage is something that I can play with the band that we can jam on. So it begins with something like that, and I'll improvise over it. And if I'm lucky, some sort of lyrical concept will come to me, and it may just start with a short sort of verbal refrain or chorus, and then I'll try to put the words together after that. The writing process has changed a little bit with the last couple of albums, and maybe it's with my my advancing age. So I'm in my 50s now, and my concept of existence is different to what it was when I was in my 20s or even my 30s. So.
Can you write a political song these days without pissing off half your audience?
Yes. I've written many, and people don't necessarily, they seem to not really know what I'm thinking. I'm best being on stage and doing the best job I can to try to bring everybody together.
Let's talk about the new album, Sovereign Town. The album sees you return to an acoustic roots format, along with a new band, Liam Keeley, Andrew Fry and Dave Clark. How did that whole concept come about?
It was quite organic and I guess fortuitous. One of the things we identified was that I'm often going on the road. It's just me with a couple of acoustic guitars. I thought, okay, well, I'll gather the acoustic songs that I've got. And I thought the songs deserved a little bit more treatment. Even just, I referred to it as gentle backing. And then around the same time I was thinking about that, I found myself in Ballarat at Matt Harding's place, a place called the Matt Cave, where he would do jam sessions and filming and so on. It was like a soundstage, great place. And Matt had invited me there to do a guitar workshop, and then he'd organised a jam session, and it was these guys, and I just clicked with them musically. I was really impressed with how they played, and I just thought, just quietly, I thought, I think these are the guys. There is no place where it don't matter now.
Why did you name the album Sovereign Town?
That was part of the evolution. So this was out at Ballarat. The song Sovereign Town, it was half written. I just kept revisiting this one. And it was one of those tunes that was hard to get out. I kind of thought I knew what it was about, but I couldn't quite complete it. The music itself, which I kept playing, and it was mostly that, this part here. I would just play that, and it would just remind me of being back home in Malmesbury when we were kids and riding our bikes out to the old gold fields, and we'd go down tunnels and look down the mine shaft, drop stones down the mine shaft and count until it dropped. Yeah, all these great big holes that had just been left there. It was like they were abandoned, and I was always fascinated by that. So I thought it was a song about us as kids, you know, doing that, and then with the drives, regular driving out to Ballarat, which is the heartland of the gold fields. I guess I just started to think about that, and I was driving past Sovereign Hill on a regular basis, and so the rest of the lyrics came together. So it's now become a song about just imagining what those guys were doing, digging all those great big holes out in the bush.
Are the songs an autobiography, or are they based on characters?
There's a song called Miniature Men, which is that began as a letter to a friend who's no longer with us. And hell, I miss you, man, wherever you are. And hell, I miss you, man. I wonder what you'd make of it all. Skeleton Kiss, which is the music video that's gone out there. You just have to read between the lines to figure out what you think that's all about. But that's, yeah, maybe that's character based, but it's also an expression of just how I feel about things.
Had in store for me. Was it Miss Destiny?
What happened at Wandsworth Bridge?
Now, Wandsworth Bridge was written when I was living in London. That's where Wandsworth Bridge is. I lived in Battersea. So I was often on Wandsworth Bridge walking to the tube and stop there. I'd just look up and down the Thames and think about what I was doing there. And it was a tough time. I'd been robbed, and I had this ongoing fight with the guy that robbed me to get my money back. I had this long-distance relationship with my girlfriend at the time, and she had sent me a letter with, I'd get these perfumed letters, and there was one time she sent me a lock of her hair, believe me, it was very comforting at the time, but I literally was on Wandsworth Bridge with them. Wow. That's where I'd gone to read the letter. Yeah.
It's been 30 something years. Have you reached the Holy Grail?
Well, my usual response is I'm just getting warmed up. I'm just starting. But look, there's been some key moments that I could hardly believe they happened. Like getting up on stage with the Allman Brothers Band was 10 minutes of like being on Mount Everest, musically speaking. I mean, that was a band that formed the blueprint in my mind of the kind of group I wanted to have. Meeting Les Paul. I got to sit in with Les Paul, traded some licks with Les.
All right, Geoff, it's time for quick shots.
Okay.
If you had a day job, what would it be?
Shit kicker.
If you could be one other person for one day, who would that be?
Donald Trump.
Good answer.
Yeah, just to try to undo a couple of things.
Yeah. Complete this line. Track of the blues.
Dr. Jules.
Yes.
Yeah.
Good man. And what's your motto?
Onward and upward.
Geoff Achison, it's been a pleasure.
Okay. Thanks, mate.
Cheers. Wrong and right and right and